Hello, I'm Richard Swann. On this month's Platts Commodity Pulse, we're going to take a look at Argentina, where the forced re-nationalisation of the former state oil company YPF has come as a severe blow to Spain's Repsol, which faces a real battle now to get some kind of value back for its biggest asset. This is really the latest in a long series of basically resource nationalism issues, not just in South America but around the world, and it really raises the stakes for oil companies operating in Argentina and actually raises some bigger questions for investment opportunities around the globe for the handful of international oil companies in the top league. Joining me today to discuss this is Robert Perkins, our senior news correspondent, and William Powell, managing editor of our International Gas Report. Robert, I think I'd like to start with you, and let's zoom in first of all on Repsol. They've been presented with a fait accompli from the Argentinian government, which basically means they've lost their biggest asset.
Somewhat. It is a huge blow for the company, you're right. I mean, the writing has been somewhat on the wall. We've had months now of signs and signals from the Argentinian government. They were looking to take a greater stake in their control in YPF, and all that had been hinting at taking basically government control of it. If you look at the Repsol share price this year, I mean, even before the takeover, the government intervention was announced last week, Repsol had already lost about 20% of its share price. So clearly investors were really concerned this was going to happen. And you're right, it's a big part of their business. YPF last year made up about 25% of Repsol's operating income. It's 500,000 barrels a day oil equivalent production. Repsol is a big player within Argentina. It's their single biggest energy company. And although it's had its internal growth rates constrained due to controls in Argentina, Repsol has really looked to it for some ways as a cash generator, a really strong cash generator, which has now been taken away from them. And as you say, we're thrown into a world of legal battles that could go on for some time.
This also raises the question of Repsol in Latin America per se. Bolivia was a big play for Repsol. They've got the field there, the Caipipendi gas field. They're the big off-taker of gas from Peru LNG. Gas in both those regions could have been sold to Argentina. Now it's not so certain whether they'll find that the natural market for that sort of gas.
And as well as being the biggest producer of oil and gas in Argentina at the moment, YPF, or Repsol, have made a giant discovery recently, a very big shale find.
Yeah, that's going to be a huge bone of contention between Repsol and the Argentinian government going forward as they go into legal battles of what exactly the YPF state was worth. As you say, there's this huge shale oil and gas discovery that Repsol made towards the end of last year in the central and southern parts of Argentina onshore, which they call the Vaca Muerta, or the Dead Cow reserves. These are shale oil and gas reserves that require a lot of money to develop. Repsol and YPF have estimated this would be a multi-billion pound per year project to develop that could be decades down the road. But it really sets the scene for Argentina in terms of giving them a template, a large resource template to develop with or without foreign partners in the future, who knows. But the interesting thing is that the government of Argentina has said, as things stand, at least, they're not assigning any value at all to those assets in terms of what they're going to give to Repsol for their share of YPF. So that's something that the market's going to be looking at very closely as things go, things head into the future.
Let's have a think about the motivation then from Argentina. We bandy the words resource nationalism around as though it was something that explains everything straight away. But there's quite complicated factors at work here. Why do you think the government's done this, Robert?
Well, you in your introduction, I mean, you'd really sort of laid the ground there. It's I guess a lot of people could see it as a continuation of governments we've seen taking much greater stake of a bigger chunk of the pie in the energy sector. Since 2002, 2003, when oil prices started to climb up from the lows, the 98 around and that kind of area. And we see a real resurgence of nationalism, of resources. We look at Venezuela, Bolivia, other places in Latin America, obvious examples, Russia. Many places have done this.
But what's the context for Argentina, though? I mean, they seem to have some particular concerns, allegations that Repsol was underinvesting in the country.
Particularly Argentina, yeah. They were claiming that really Repsol was using YPF as a cash cow, taking funds out of the country without reinvesting it to produce oil and gas. Argentina's oil and gas output has been falling for many years. They're looking to reinstate that, to increase production. They were claiming Repsol wasn't doing enough to do that. Repsol, on the other hand, claims that, well, it was simply as a result of domestic price controls on fuel products. that meant there was no incentive for them to invest, and other issues. So there is a political issue, political angle, particularly in Argentina, because as many observers of Latin American politics will know, the Kirchner government follows very closely, is allied with Chavez, left-wing populist regimes who have supported in the past this model of taking a much stronger role, nationalizing assets, or in this case, the YPF re-nationalizing assets, and as I say, in taking a stronger role in their own production going forward.
And different countries have got different reasons for these displays of resource nationalism. When Russia took control of the Sakhalin energy project, it diminished the shares of the other partners. Gazprom became the dominant partner. It thereby gained access to export markets for LNG. Incidentally, it also learned how to negotiate and how to enforce an LNG contract. That was very important for Gazprom, which was, of course, also the export monopoly, even though it was it was a production sharing agreement. If you look at Kazakhstan, there the government forced its way in to get the Kashagan project, again sensing this was a very, very big project. It hadn't got enough share of the proceeds for that, and so it became the biggest shareholder in that.
That's right, and I think, you know, as we said, the desire, the motivation from the government to take a bigger stake in the energy pie, as energy prices have really rocketed in the last 10, 15 years, is a massive motivation, and different countries approach this different ways. You know, resource nationalization perhaps is an extreme example. You know, expropriating assets that we've seen in Bolivia, Venezuela. But at the other end of the spectrum, you could equally point to windfall taxes, increased taxes on upstream production in countries like the UK, announced an upstream tax hike last year. Upstream producers weren't too happy about. A number of countries have renegotiated terms on contracts. So a slightly softer version, obviously, of the same, but achieving the same kind of effect. And you know, I think that's interesting to put it into perspective. The motivation is still there, although they approach it different ways.
But also, it is a tug of war between the country, the host government, and the IOC. If you look at examples such as Algeria, they were very harsh on investors, with the consequence that the contracts were so unattractive that in the last 3 years they've only been able to award 11 upstream blocks. This is because the terms weren't good enough, and there now they seem to be falling behind on their production targets. So it is really a balancing act or a tug of war, depending how you look at it, whose interests will prevail. It depends on the market, depends on the very often circumstances well beyond the control of either host government or of the IOC.
Clearly, these kind of resource nationalistic policies are going to make investment difficult for companies. That's clear, although profits are still pretty high at most of them. I think another thing that's complicating life for the BPs, Shell, Exxons of this world is the fact that they're having to compete on the international scale with state oil companies who are no longer content with sort of just managing their domestic oil and gas industries. They're stepping out, competing on the international scale for the kind of investments opportunities that I think the Western oil majors used to think were their kind of exclusive reserve.
That's right. I mean, the obvious example here is the massive purchasing power that Asian economy, particularly in China as an example, has really directed outside its country on buying up resources, oil, gas, coal, really wanting to get its hands on. It's a massive consuming nation in terms of resources of oil and energy in particular. I think China alone in the last 7 years has spent about $64 billion overseas, getting stakes in projects, acquiring projects. This has been all over the world, in Africa, in South America, in Venezuela is a good example. For example, after the oil nationalizations there, China was a huge investor with oil for loan deals with the Chavez government. You name it, there's been a massive surge of investment picking up in big projects. So I think that going forward, that's something people expect to do. And I think it's also interesting to point out that the West, you know, the oil demand is really flatlining in the West. And the oil consuming nations, particularly China and others, South Korea in the region, are really coming into their own as a force with huge deep pockets to go out and buy resources and just simply to have the security of supply in the future.
Yeah, South Korea, they're trying to get big into Canadian shale, as are Japanese companies. There's a Thai company, PTT, which almost bought, in fact, it still may offer a counterbid for Cove Energy, for its Mozambique assets, which are clearly LNG oriented. So yes, these used to be the preserves of the majors. Now we're competing, if you like, against the national companies with more government-directed rather than shareholder-directed concerns, such as energy security of supply. I think Korea wants to ensure a certain amount of its annual production is secured by equity. Japan has similar sort of objectives. Mm. It's very hard for the majors to compete against those sorts of agendas.
So how do they do that? I mean, you just alluded to this. If you're competing against somebody whose bidding criteria for a particular asset is not economic, it's probably political, it's security of supply or something else, that enables them essentially to pay more than you for these assets. So what's left if you can't compete for those kind of assets? What do the Western oil majors, who are the public face of this industry, what do they do?
Well, I suppose you could argue that, you know, first of all, the low-hanging fruit, okay, those might be beyond your pockets because... But however, where you can add value is in the difficult, challenging terrain, such as the offshore in the Arctic, where Exxon and recently Eni have now both done deals or signed agreements with Rosneft. There's those sort of territories, there's the whole area of the Arctic, which is up for grabs, so we're told. So there are areas where it's not so much the pockets you need, it's the experience, the technology, and it's maybe being a bit more nimble. And of course, not being a government-owned company, you don't have any government conflicts in a way that, say, China might have if it tried to do a deal with Russia, where it then become much more tense owing to the politics involved.
Yeah. No, I think for sure there is a growing interdependence between consuming and producing NOCs around the world. But in terms of what the limitations of those are, I mean, the obvious ones, linguistic and cultural, you get Chinese companies coming to South America, they've got to learn a whole new set of rules, and whether or not they're comfortable with that on either side of is questionable, or how fast they can integrate is questionable. Funnily enough, there's an interesting parallel with Repsol here, which is worth pointing out. Repsol has said that before the government in Argentina took over YPF, it was very, very close to a deal selling its YPF 57% YPF stake to Sinopec of China, Chinese state-backed company, which valued the stake to $18 billion. Now, that's interesting because that deal essentially is perhaps still on the table, and the speculation is rife really that Argentina, now in control of YPF, will go back to the Chinese and say, would you like to take part in this project? You know, it's from the West point of view, IOCs may see it as a really high risk prospect, given just what the nationalization has happened and the precedent's been set there. They may stand back, but governments, government-backed oil companies work with different kind of rules and regulations. So there's clearly could well be a role for China there, specifically developing YPF's massive shale oil and gas blocks.
I also think it's instructive that following the recent events in Argentina, companies are queuing up now to take some of those assets, and they're also queuing up to take assets in Russia. Now, they need reserve replacement. It's a very important metric for the market. They need to keep showing the market, look, we have all these fields still to be developed. We've got very long order books, and that's what shareholders like, and that's what analysts like. And I think, you know, no matter what the experience of countries has been in the past, the majors still need the oil and the gas. Mm. So Russia has them, you know, Argentina has it. That's where people will have to go.
That's right. I mean, there are really forced into higher risk areas, you know, looking at areas where there hasn't been much drilling done before, perhaps politically slightly more benign than states such as Venezuela and Argentina. Obviously, we have massive gas offshore East Africa, Africa, and also West Africa, large oil finds there. We see frontier exploration in the Arctic, Greenland, those kind of areas where we're really pushing the boundaries in terms of where companies can go to explore and then being forced to do that. So I think that's a trend that you'll see continuing as really the access to these to the remaining world reserves become more and more dominated by consuming and producing countries, the NOCs from both sides.
Well, thanks both very much. We've covered an awful lot of ground today. But that's all from this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse.